Welcome back to the Premier League show, and it's that time of the week where we wrap it all up. It's the second round of fixtures in the Premier League, and it was another fantastic weekend of football. We had some delightful shocks in the league. It really was good fun this weekend. I am recording this straight off the bat of getting back from the London Stadium. It was my first time there. I had a great time. It's a lovely stadium. It's just not quite Upton Park, but we will talk about that in a moment. Now, let's crack on with this week's wrap-up. Right, guys, so I usually start this with, I usually talk about not so much the game that I picked as game of the week, but the one that ended up being game of the week. Now, as far as I'm concerned, there really wasn't an outstanding game of the week this week, but there was a performance of the week, and it has to go to Burnley. So we're going to talk about Burnley versus Liverpool first up. Now, Burnley, those that don't know, run out 2-0 winners, and you have to say, for Burnley to go and beat Liverpool 2-0 any day of the week, that is a very, very fine result. And I think they ultimately deserved it as well at the end of the day. Sam Vokes popped up in the second minute with a beautiful turn and shot. Lovely goal straight past the keeper. And then Andre Gray popped up in the 37th minute. And a very, very good effort. He did really well, two fine touches past the player, and then he bent it in the bottom corner, and that was it. Burnley run out 2-0 winners. Now, we have to say the positives from this game is that Burnley went and got 3 points, and although Burnley only had 19% of the possession, they still managed to come out of the game with the win, and it's because they did what Liverpool didn't. They converted their chances. They didn't have many chances, but when they did have a chance, they took it. And that's what you've got to do. And I think another positive, it has to go to Andre Gray. This guy has gone from non-league to Premier League. There's been a lot of shit going around recently, I've been reading, that he's been getting it in the neck because of tweets that he tweeted that were homophobic and all the rest of it when he was a bit younger, and when his head weren't right. He's come out and he's defended himself. We all do silly things. We all write stupid stuff on Twitter. I've done it. Fuck, what are they gonna do if I ever get famous? Or are they gonna drag that up and try and make a martyr of me? I think it's wrong. I feel a bit sorry for him. But a positive is, as far as this game is concerned, he's gone from non-league to Premier League, and he looks like a Premier League player. I have to say, from this game, he was probably Burnley's standout player. As well as Stephen Defoe, I thought he was very good. Sam Vokes did well. But Burnley as a whole did well. But I thought Andre Gray really, really did stand out. And if he can score goals regularly, then, Burnley could be all right. And the most important thing for Burnley is you have to win at home. You have to win at home. And this was a massive result for them. It really, really was. I was really impressed. They might not have had much of the possession, but when they did have the ball, they did well with it. And, you can't ask for more than that. Now, the negative has to be, what the fuck has happened to Liverpool? Liverpool cannot have these 50-50 weeks. Last week, they were exceptional in the second half against Arsenal. 4-1 up at one point. They really, really were good. But I did say they looked dodgy at the back, and obviously they conceded 3 goals. And it just proved how dodgy they are at the back, because they've gone and conceded 2 goals, against Burnley away from home. I honestly thought after last week, they'd have the wind in their sails, they'd turn up at Burnley and they'd turn them over and they'd, just absolutely annihilate them. And they did anything but. They really were a disappointment. They had all that possession. They had a ridiculous amount of shots. All right, fair play to Burnley for forcing Liverpool to take shots, from outside the box. A lot of long shots and all the rest of it, and restricting them to very little in front of goal. But still, Liverpool have got to be better than this. Liverpool, they can't be losing games like this. And, I'm sure, Klopp will be on their case this week in training. He's got to be. He looked dejected. He looked like he didn't know what had fucking happened at the end of that game. And the trouble is, and this is the biggest problem with Liverpool, and I've just tackled it, Liverpool are great going forward. They're terrible at the back. But the trouble is, as great as they are going forward, when they can't score, they're just a bit of a mess of a team. They're a bit like Arsenal, aren't they? And it still needs work. They're not the finished article. It was a disappointing result for Liverpool. It really was. And I think another negative, and I hate to drag it up, but some of their players. Milner at left back. What's that all about? Firmino looks lost. Firmino looks like, when he was in Germany, he looked like a world beater, and since he's joined Liverpool, he just looks a bit lost. You know, Klopp does get the best out of him, you know, better than, you know, the previous manager did, but still, in this game, he looked all over the place. You know, the only one player I've noted that really, really does it week in, week out for him is Coutinho, and, you know, he's just got to be better. He's just got to be better, but, you know, great result for Burnley. Good on them getting the 3 points against a club like Liverpool. Next up, guys, we're going to tackle Manchester United versus Southampton. And this is an interesting one, and this is one I want to kind of tackle a little bit. Manchester United run out 2-0 winners. Ibrahimovic scored both of the goals. The first goal was a lovely header. Got a lot of power in it, didn't he? Straight in that bottom corner, lovely goal. And then the second was a penalty. And I personally, I'm not sure if there was any contact on Shaw. He went down a bit easy, didn't he? Diving in football does my fucking head in, really does. But Ibra stepped up, put the penalty away. Lovely stuff, 2-0, and a good win for Manchester United. And I think that, and you know, it's the title of this video, the fear factor. Manchester United, back in the day, they used to have this enigma, they used to have this stigma about them that was, you know, you'd lose the game before you even stepped on the pitch. And it was mainly because when they were stood in the tunnel at Old Trafford, opposing teams would look to the right and they would see players like Paul Scholes, you know, Ryan Giggs, David Beckham, Cristiano Ronaldo, Peter Schmeichel, Van der Sar, Steve Bruce, Gary Pallister, Gary Neville, you know, Eric Cantona. They've always had such good players, and the teams have always been psychologically beat a team before they even stepped on the pitch. But for years, Man United haven't had that. They've had, since Ferguson left, they haven't had that. You know, they've not had the scary, you know, players, and they've not had that. They've not had the, oh, how do I want to put it? They've not had that. You know, you step on the pitch and it's like, wow, this is a world-class team. They've just not had that in the last few years. But Mourinho's walked through the door, he's looked at the players that he wants, he's signed them, and you've got to admit, teams are going to look there now. Don't get me wrong, Man United are not the finished article. They still need a lot of work, in my opinion. But you've got to be honest. If you look to your right and you see Paul Pogba, Ibrahimovic, Anthony Martial, Juan Mata, you know, Eric Bailey, he's mustard. What a player he is. You're looking at that, you know, De Gea. That's a scary team. And not only that, they've got Mourinho. And Mourinho is the best at the mind games. And he's got Man United sorted. I just feel that the fear factor's back. And this is a massive positive. If I haven't already said, I think this, as far as for Man United fans, this has got to be a massive positive. It feels like, you know, Southampton played really well in this game, but it felt like Southampton knew they probably weren't going to win this game. They probably weren't going to get past Manchester United. And it happened before a ball was even kicked. And I feel like the fear factor is working its way back into Manchester United. Another positive from this game, Paul Pogba, he made his debut. And it has to be said, I thought he played very, very well. Really, really, really did get up and down the park. He had a few chances. I actually thought he was going to score at one point. I thought he had a really good second debut for the team. And I'm sure that Mourinho would be very, very pleased with that. I actually thought Wayne Rooney was a bit better. I still feel like he's a bit slow and he's not really for that team, but his ball in for Ibrahimovic's goal was mustard, weren't it? And just overall, Man United just looked good again. And I'm going to take nothing away from Southampton. I think a positive is that, you know, Southampton did turn up, they did give it a go. You know, none of their chances really were, I don't know, none of them were particularly scary, none of them were something that De Gea or the defence couldn't handle, but they did give it a go. They did turn up. They did, you know, they did play very, very well. And I don't think Southampton have got much to worry about. I think, you know, like I say, I feel like Man United beat them before the ball was even kicked. And I really don't see any negatives from this game. I think both teams played well, and I feel like the Mourinho era is in full effect. And next up, guys, we're going to take Stoke versus Manchester City, and Manchester City run out 4-1 winners in this game. Sergio Aguero scored a penalty after, you know, a player was pulled down. I think it was Otamendi in the box. Mike Dean gave the penalty. Sergio Aguero tucked it away. Then there was a free kick. Come in the box. Aguero rose higher than anyone else, even though he's one of the smallest men on the pitch. A header in the back of the net. Poor defending from Stoke. Then the second half rolled around and a similar incident happened in City's box, and Stoke rewarded the penalty. 2-1, Bojan puts it away, and then in the final few minutes, Nolito managed to score two goals, and that was it, 4-1, that's all she wrote, another win for Manchester City. Now, I would say the positives are that the winning mentality is creeping into City. Guardiola is a winner, he doesn't lose very many games, and I feel like he's getting that into the players' heads that you need to win, and you need to keep going till the very, very end of the game. You know, the fact they scored, you know, their fourth goal in the 95th minute just tells you that he wants to score as many goals as possible. He just wants to play to that final whistle. And City, you know, they look half decent, and I feel like slowly they're, you know, sort of taking on board what Guardiola is trying to teach them. A negative is that they can't do it for 90 minutes. The first 45, they were exceptional. Stoke had no answer for them. Second half, though, was a completely different picture. He had to make a few changes to sort of liven it up a bit. And, you know, I don't know, you've got to do it for 90 minutes in the Premier League. I don't want to say too much more. And I think that's something that Guardiola will learn. I think the biggest negative for me from this game is just Stoke in general in this game. My biggest issue was, when it went 2-1 and I was watching the game, I was thinking to myself, right, Stoke will give it a go now. They'll get back in this because, you know, there's one goal in it. They'll have a go. They'll get at City and all the rest of it. But they did anything but. They let City straight back in the game. And they sat back and they didn't make an effort. And there was a lot of players massively underperformed in that game. I'm sure Mark Hughes was really disappointed in the performance. And it's not that they don't have the players. They had a very good team out. It was a poor performance, a really, really poor performance. And considering Stoke were at home and they're usually exceptional at home, this didn't feel that way. They really did feel a bit off the pace in this game. Just Stoke were just a big, big disappointment. And I want to end this with the Manchester City v Stoke game on, in my opinion, it's a positive note, and it's not on either of the teams, but it's on the referee, and it's on Mike Dean. Now, Mike Dean was getting a bit of stick from a lot of the TV shows. I feel, you know, Match of the Day were talking about it, and, you know, Lineker disagreed, Neville agreed, you know, BT Sport were talking about it, all the, you know, and they all had their opinions, but a lot of them were quite negative towards Mike Dean. And me personally, I feel that Mike Dean did an exceptional job on both of the penalties in this game. Okay, I feel like Stokes was a little bit soft, and I feel like he was trying to even it up a little bit. But it took a lot of bottle for Mike Dean to give both those penalties, because he gave penalties for stuff that happens in the box every fucking week in the Premier League, and something needed to be done about it. It really did, because it's one of those things that's really fucking annoying when players get pulled off the ball and they get tugged to the floor, their shirt gets pulled, and there could be a clear goal scoring opportunity and it's denied by that, and the ref just turns a blind eye to it and runs away like a fucking melon. But Mike Dean stood up for it. You know, he's got nuts like fucking melons, because he didn't give a shit in this game, because he gave one at either end, and we must commend Mike Dean for that. I feel like that's exceptional refereeing, and we don't get to say that very often in today's game. Next up, it's Swansea versus Hull, and we have to say, it's another shock, isn't it? It is. It's another big, big shock win for Hull. Hull run out 2-0 winners in this one. Sean Maloney scored the first goal. It was, you know, a little chesty into the goal, a little shimmy chest into the goal. It was a lovely little thing. He just guided it in. And the last and the second goal was scored by Abel Hernandez, and that's 2-2 for him. Hull, the better team on the day again. Swansea were in this. You know, they had chances. They did well. They played very well. Just Hull were the better team on the day. Obviously, I don't feel like it's a negative as far as Swansea are concerned. It's one of those days at the office. It happens to everyone. Like I say, Swansea played very well, and I thought they were decent. And I don't really feel like I've got much to say about Swansea on this one. The only thing I want to say is they need to tighten up a little bit at the back, because they got caught on the counter a fair amount in this game. But they did have a go, and they went for it to the final whistle. And, you know, that's a positive. The biggest positive from this game, though, is Hull City win again. And it's the way they won was brilliant. They played good football. They passed the ball around well. And, you know, they were very, very good in the second half on the counter-attack. Really good, in fact. You know, Abel Hernandez's goal was a solid counter-attacking goal. The sort of stuff you want to see from your football team. And, you know, it has to be said, another positive is Snodgrass is their standout player at the moment. He is looking like a real, real talent for Hull. I know he's been playing a long time, and I have seen him play for, you know, other teams. I've seen him play for Hull and stuff, and I know he's had some real shocking injuries in his time as well, but he is looking fucking excellent this season. The two games he's played, he's been the standout player on the pitch for Hull. What a player, and, you know, just what a performance. And all we have to finish this with, there's no negatives in this, because, you know, I had Hull nailed on for relegation this season. All of the crap they've got going on, I covered it last week. I'm not going to cover it again, but they've got so much shit going on off the pitch. They don't even have a full-time manager. And I'm going to finish with this for all the Hull fans watching. If the Hull fucking chairman even manages to come across my channel, give Mike Phelan the job, because he's doing a fucking job at Hull. That's 6 points for them. Exceptional stuff. Long may it continue. Next up, it's going to be Tottenham versus Crystal Palace, and I haven't got much to say about this one because it was one of those frustrating games, wasn't it? Tottenham ended up running out 1-0 winners. Wanyama scored the goal. It was assisted by Harry Kane. He headed it in the box, you know, Wanyama headed it on. It ended up in the back of the net, and this was a frustrating game for me because Spurs were on top the whole time, the whole 90 minutes. I can't remember Crystal Palace having very many opportunities. I think, you know, one or two real opportunities for them in the game. Tottenham were by far the better team. That's the positive, is that Tottenham look like a very good team. They just look a bit short in front of goal, but I feel like as the season goes on, you get sharper, you score more goals. But Spurs, they look good. They look good. They dominated this game. They could have won it at a canter. They missed a lot of chances, but they come away with 3 points, and that's all important. That's the only important thing, isn't it, at the end of the day. Now, I'm going to go into the negatives, and the negative is just Crystal Palace and Alan Pardew. What the fuck is going on? They were awful in this game. Real, real awful. And the thing I want to tackle as well is they're selling all their players and they're not replacing them. Don't get me wrong, I know Jedinak has gone to Villa and he wasn't, you know, your first team player all the time. And the same with Dwight Gale, he's gone to Newcastle and he weren't playing week in, week out. That's fair enough. You want to sell the dead wood, you sell the dead wood. But you can't go selling players like Bolasie and then not replacing them, because you're going to get found out and you're going to struggle like you did in this game against Spurs. Palace were fucking disgusting. They were awful. They were on the level of West Brom in this game. And we all know how I felt about West Brom in the last, you know, few games and last few years even. And they were just awful. And I feel like Alan Pardew has got a hell of a job to do. He needs to get some signings in, because if he don't, I feel like it's only a matter of time before they say, bye-bye, Alan, go find another job. We're going to get a manager that can do what we need him to do. Because at the end of the day, Palace is, you know, trying to sign some big players now. And they've got some big players on the books. You know, Yohan Cabaye, but whatever. He ain't done it really, has he, since he come back. But they need work on and off the pitch. They really were a shambles. And that's all I'm going to say on it. Just a shambles. Next up, we are going to take Watford versus Chelsea, and Chelsea ended up running out 2-1 winners. Watford, Etienne Capoue with another absolute thunder cunt of a shot. in the top corner, lovely stuff. And then Chelsea turned it on, and didn't they, in the last like 10 minutes. And Batshuayi popped up, he scored a shot as it rebounded off the goalkeeper, and then Diego Costa with a goal, again, 2-2. What a beautiful ball from Fabregas it was for Diego Costa's goal though, and great composure from the striker. Now, I feel like the positive from this game is, see, it's a weird one now for Watford, because I'm going to do, it's almost like 50-50. Now, for 70 minutes of this game, Watford were the better team. They really were. They were incredible. Great on the counter-attack. And for that final 20 minutes, they switched off. And they handed Chelsea the victory. So it's really hard. I don't know whether it's a negative or a positive there for Watford. I feel like if Watford carry on playing like this all season, though, they're going to be fine. And they've got some good players. And another thing as well is that before a ball was even kicked in this game, they confirmed the signing of two new players. They've signed Pereira from Juventus and Younes Kabul from Sunderland. So that's positive. That's working the transfer window, and that's going to help with the squad, and it's going to help make them better. That's a positive. That's definitely a positive. And I feel like, really, if we're really getting into this, Chelsea are a big team, aren't they? So a positive is that Watford, they give it a go, and they basically took Chelsea to the 90th minute at the end of the day. So it's a positive. Let's not get on Watford's back too much. You can't help it. You get beat, don't you? It's one of those things. Another positive is it's another 3 points for Chelsea. And although Chelsea were under the cosh at times and they weren't really in the game, they did what champions do, and they ground it out, and they managed to, you know, score the winning goal. And you know, Chelsea are starting to look like their old selves again. I really do feel like, you know, they're getting back to their best. They look like they've got a manager that ain't going to take any shit. He wants to get the wins. He don't lose many games. He's a bit like Guardiola. And yeah, they look like they're slowly getting back to their best. It was good to see Batshuayi as well pop up with his first goal for the club. Eden Hazard is looking like a real good player again this season under the new manager. I'd say the only negative really for Chelsea is that they let Watford in a little too much, didn't they? And you can't afford to do that in the Premier League, because all the teams are getting a lot closer to each other. But another good result for Chelsea. Next up, it's West Bromwich Albion versus Everton, and Everton run out 2-1 winners. Negative, West Bromwich Albion, I'm not going to go into it. You get on my nerves as a football club. Tony Pulis, up and down that fucking touchline. You're getting on my tits, mate. Get that, they're in the transfer market, and sort some players out, because the West Brom fans deserve better than that shit. Fuck. Positive, Everton. Ronald Koeman, they look good, didn't they? You know, Kevin Morales scored their first goal. Gareth Barry scored a goal for the first time in about 900 years. But they just look good under Koeman again, and he's made some positive signings on the counter-attack. Really, really good. I'm keeping Everton v West Brom short and sweet, because I feel like I'm repeating what I said about the two clubs last week. Neither have really moved on from there. Everton got slightly better because they managed to get 3 points and they got a win. West Brom have gone absolutely fucking nowhere. They've signed no players and they're still as boring as they have always been. Again, I'm nervous, West Brom. I want you to be competitive. I want you to get involved, for fuck's sake. Sort it out. Come on. It's all about your chairman and your manager. And I don't hate West Brom, for all the West Brom fans, you know, sitting here. I get pissed off because you, the fans, deserve better than what you get on that pitch. It was fucking awful. West Brom, no. Everton, though, I feel like they could be the dark horses if they sign some good players. And the fact that it's been confirmed as well, you know, this is a big positive that Lukaku is staying for at least another season. You can't get better than that, because the guy's mustered in front of goal. And, you know, that's all I have to say on this. Let's move on, shall we? And next up, we have Leicester versus Arsenal. And this one ended up 0-0, poor draw. Fucking wet blanket, load of old shit. I actually had this down as my game of the week, and it ended up being a proper bore fest. Arsenal have nothing about them. Leicester look off the fucking pace. It was, it just wasn't good, was it? Both teams had shots, both can put it in the back of the net, and it was just painful to watch. I feel like a positive, though, is that Leicester got a point, and they showed that they're competitive against the big boys, and to be honest with you, they were better than Arsenal on the day. It's as simple as that. The negative is just Arsenal and Arsene Wenger. The fans are not happy, and I can understand why they're not happy. You've got all that money and you're not spending any of it, you're not signing any good players, and then he has the cheek to come out and say, I don't have to explain myself why we're not spending money, I don't feel like you have to throw this, that and that, the other, you know, at clubs and spend all this money and blah, 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 blah. We've heard it all before, Arsene. We've heard it all before. You need to move on. If you can't move on at the club and sort it out, move on and let another manager come in and do it, because you got a feel for that club. They're a big club and they haven't won much. Like, they haven't won a league title in fucking forever, and they've only won the FA Cup, and they're not competitive in Europe. And you can't help but feel sorry for that club, even as a West Ham fan, because if it was happening to my club, I'd be fucking pissed off. I really would. I would not be happy with that. It's as simple as that. And it just annoys me. How is he still in that job? It's a big job. And the fact that you're getting mugged off by Leicester. Alright, you got a point out of it, but Leicester were better than you on the day. They really, really were. Another negative to come from the game was Mendy, unfortunately, for Leicester, picked up an injury, because I thought he looked really good in the game. He was really in it, and oh, for anyone that watched it, Studs got stuck in the ground, twisted his ankle, and it looks like he's going to be out for a little while, and he bollocks that. So it's a negative, because that was a signing they brought in to replace Kante, and I've got to be honest, he looked like a direct replacement, and he looked like he was going to do a job. But yeah, let's hope that next week these two can go out and get wins and just give it a go, because both just, they look off the pace at the minute. And Arsenal especially, they need some work. They really do. They need a good kick up the arse, and then players need to take a good look at themselves. And Arsene probably needs to take the biggest look at himself in the mirror and ask himself if he wants to do this anymore, because he don't look like he wants to. Next up, guys, we come to Sunderland versus Middlesbrough. And 2-1, Middlesbrough win, and yeah, Middlesbrough were the better team on the day. They went 2-0 up in the first half. Stuani scored both goals, and Negredo had a part to play in both of those goals as well. He assisted both, and Negredo's looking good. Sudley did get back in it in the second half through Patrick Van Aanholt, and I've got to be honest, in the first half of this game, I felt like I was watching two teams that could be relegated. It was shocking at the beginning, and then once Stuani's got that goal, the game really come alive, and Middlesbrough look like they got something about them. This is my positive from this game, is that Middlesbrough are looking like they really do look like they've got something about them. The signings they've made are real, real positive signings. Karanka's doing a great job there. He has been doing a good job there since he took over, even when they were in the Championship, and he's continued it into the Premier League. And I feel like Negredo is going to be a real key figure in how they get on this season. Now, he may not have scored today, but like I say, he got 2 assists. He was in the game. You know, I thought he was one of their better players. I thought he did very, very well. And I feel like Middlesbrough, when they get going, they look good. And the thing is as well, the key to staying up is scoring goals. And Middlesbrough, two games, they've scored 3 goals and they've got 4 points. You can't ask for much more than that. It was a great weekend for the newly promoted teams, it has to be said. I don't feel like this one's as much of a shock as the other two victories were. I felt like, you know, Sunderland are that sort of team that are there for the taking if you go at them, and that's what Middlesbrough did. Now, the negative I have to say from this game is that Sunderland really, really let themselves down, because last week against City, they really looked decent, and they could have, you know, nicked the win or nicked a point against City last week. And in this one, they looked like they run out of ideas. They didn't look quite into their game. David Moyes was playing people in very strange positions. Really didn't make sense to me. And Sunderland are really going to have to get their act together very, very quickly, or they're going to find themselves in a hell of a lot of trouble early in the season. And, you know, you don't want to have a real shocking start, because it's harder to get back into it. And I know the season's long, but the longer this goes on, the harder it is to turn it around. And, you know, Sunderland are one of those teams that are going to be down there in that relegation dogfight, and they really, really need to get themselves sorted out quick so that they don't get dragged into it from the get-go. You know, they were down there all last season. Do they really want another year like that? David Moyes needs to get some work done, and I feel like Sunderland, you know, they need a bit more consistency if they want to, you know, remain in the Premier League. And last, but by no means least, this week is West Ham versus Bournemouth. And West Ham run out 1-0 winners. Michel Antonio with the goal, back post header, 85th minute, and we came away with the victory. I'm going to start on a negative, and it involves both teams, and it was just the game in general. I went, I'm a season ticket holder, I went. It was my first time at the ground. Lovely and all that, but the game was a bit shit. At no point in the game did Bournemouth look like they were going to trouble us until the very end, and West Ham's build-up play was slow, very lethargic. Some players looked like they didn't want to be there, and yeah, just the game as a whole was a bit boring. It lacked fire. It wasn't a very good game, in my opinion. I don't know if there's any other guys that watch this, West Ham fans or Bournemouth even, that when they see the game and you disagree, let me know in the comments if so. But I just felt like it was a real boring game. Another negative was, you know, Harry Arter's sending off was stupid. That is a stupid, stupid sending off. And, you know, you've put yourself in a silly position on both occasions, and then you've left your team, you know, down to 10 men, and you've, you know, at the end of the day, it was that sending off that ended up leading to our goal, because we could apply more pressure, you know, in the game. My big positive from the game, though, is that it finally seems as though Bilic has seen that Antonio is not a right back, he is more of an attacking player, and Antonio, along with Coyote, Antonio was probably West Ham's best player on the day. He has such an attacking threat. If it was left up to me, I'd turn him into a striker. His leap is unbelievable. He can head the ball, he can, you know, he can shoot with both feet. He's got it all. I really do think he's got it all. With a bit of patience and a bit of coaching, I think you could turn him into a really good striker. He can't be any worse than fucking Valencia. Christ, that guy's got two left feet. He looks like he ties the laces on each shoe together. He is fucking awful. His first touch is disgusting. Oh my God, he can't be any worse than that. But yeah, it finally seems as though Bilic has, you know, seen that Antonio is, you know, more of a forward-thinking player. And the other positive to come from this game has to be that Bilic managed to get a result, even with all of the injuries that we have at West Ham. You know, Carroll's out for 6 weeks, Figuli's out for, you know, up, you know, until next month sometime. You know, Ayew's out till December, minimum. You know, Lanzini's out, Payet's not 100%. You know, we've got real issues at West Ham, you know, and he still managed to get a positive result. And we were still the better team on the day. Now, another negative has to be Bournemouth's performance. And, you know, if Bournemouth perform like that for the rest of the season, honestly, that it was that bad, they will get relegated. They were shit in this game. The fact we come out of this with a win, and we probably played 50% of our potential, shows you how bad Bournemouth were. In the first half, they couldn't complete a pass. The man got sent off, and they actually become a better team after that, unbelievably. We actually had, you know, they had a chance in the injury minutes, you know, after the 90, and Adrian had to pull up a good save. You know, Caleri for us got released through not long after, and he managed to squiff one wide, but enough said about that. But yeah, they really, really didn't look good at all. And I'm saving the biggest negative till last, and I've sort of mentioned it already, and it is Antonio Valencia. What words escape me on how bad a footballer I think this guy is. He is pretty much the worst signing I have ever had to watch over there. He is awful. He is awful. And his body language when he got subbed as well just told the story that he clearly doesn't want to be there. He doesn't want to play for the team. He don't give a shit. There's no passion. You know, his first touch always gets away from him. Fuck, it's just, it's so horrendous. The guy is so bad. He is so bad. He's shit. He's so, so shit. You know, he never chases the ball down. No determination in his play. He never gets in the keeper's space. He never makes it hard for anyone. And when he shoots, it goes, you know, high and wide. He is just a disgusting footballer. And, you know, if I've got a bit of advice from Bilic, don't play him anymore. Because the more you play him, the less likely it is that we're going to sell him. Because other teams are going to see him play and be like, fuck, they want how much for him? Stop. Just try and get rid of him. If you get £1 million for him, I'll come and shake your hand, mate. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'll do your washing up for the week. That's how bad I think he is. He's fucking awful. And the sooner we see the back of that mug, the better. That is all I'm saying. So there you have it, guys. Week 2 of the Premier League is done and dusted, and it was a great week of football. Obviously, it is still early in the season, and you know, things can only get better as it goes on. But some shock results have already, you know, been thrown at us, and you know, teams that we thought weren't going to do very well, you know, are punching well above their weight. Now, if you've enjoyed this episode of The Wrap Up, make sure you're showing your boy some love, dropping me a like on the video. If this is your first time, you have visited my channel and you like what you see, make sure you smash the shit out of that subscribe button. But until next time, I've been Dan, you've been a legend. This has been the Premier League Wrap-Up Show. Peace out, my homies. I'll see you next time.